Thank you.
Just ask if, just say, wait till she's speaking and then ask, can you hear?
Do you actually have tea? Oh my goodness, now guys, wait a minute, you gotta come up forward here. What is this like? You know? This is like my directing class at USC, everybody's trying to get in the last row and not the scene. Are you okay over there?
I'm fine.
All right. Because then I can see you and we can talk to each other. Might as well, you guys came out in the end of the world rain.
Kenny, you can sit over here.
You don't wanna come up? Come on up. Wanna come up, guys? Come on up. Silly beans.
She'll give up.
We have to turn this fan off, please, because I'm about to blow away. Yes, thank you. It's great, though. Great air.
On the front.
On the face, Janet.
Oh, yeah. This is, what did I call this class?
No holds barred.
I knew it was a wrestling hold, yeah. No holds barred. My name is Lindsay Krause, and tonight is June 26th. This is my anniversary, my marriage anniversary. 14.
Wow.
14. Rick is at home registering people for the summer retreat.
So romantic.
I know. But he's trying to do that. Welcome, guys. Come on in and come on up to the front and everything. Make noise. Come on, we haven't started.
Woo!
All right.
There are plenty of seats.
Look, there's two seats here. What's the matter with those? Nobody has it. Come on, you have the courage to really.
Lindsay says.
Because I really want to want to speak powerfully to you tonight. We, you know, we come into this room again and again and various other places with great teachers, Buddhist and Christian and Jewish and Muslim and etc. Because we want something for our lives. We want it now, right? We want to have meaningful, rich, good lives. We sense that we are good folks. We want to get the results. We do. I mean, we have to be honest. We want to get the results of all our trying. So I want to be a real force to help you do that every step of the way, and I want to keep doing that this summer as many times as I can come back here and teach you. So how many people tonight are here who are completely new, not just to me, but to perhaps Buddhism or this place or any of these kinds of things? Quite a few of you. Welcome. Yay. I'm very glad you're here. Thank you for coming. What we teach here is what they call liberation, which means freedom. Freedom from the kind of suffering that you have every day, the kind of annoyance or bitterness or jealousy or regret or guilt or sadness or depression, freedom from all of that. And that's a tall order. And we can't rely on anybody but ourselves in order to engineer that. Because we're the ones who know what our history is, what we've done, what we've said, what we've thought, and what we think now about all of that. So the first thing I want to say to you, can you see me? The gentleman in the back. Okay, because I can't see you. Will you guys squish over? I just want to be able to see every face in the room. Thank you. Nobody can free us. We have to free ourselves. So tonight I'm going to try and give you some hot tips from Krauss about how to free yourselves of your afflictions. The great news is that most of our afflictions are in fact created. They're created by us. It's a hard thing to admit until you begin to understand a Buddhist worldview. It's a hard thing to think about. We think, wait a minute, you know, this happened and that happened and I had nothing to do with that and it just came out of the blue and et cetera, et cetera. But most of the things that we suffer from, in a way, are made up by us, are creations of our own minds. So the first thing I wanted to, especially for those of you who have been here before, is give a little teaching about one of the most extraordinary principles in Buddhism, which is based on the fact that everything is changing. Everything is changing all the time. They say 3 trillion times a second. So all those particles that we're made of are atoms and subatomic particles and quarks and bosons and on down and down and down. They're moving so rapidly that without very fine instruments, you can't even really find them. You can only find the traces of the fact that they were there and moving around so quickly. Everything in the universe is like that. This table is like that. These raspberries are like that. We are all like that. We are flow. We are energy and information whirling around like an incredible field of potential. And that is what we are. The idea that there is a me here, that there is an I here, an actual fixed identity, Lindsay Krauss, is a kind of absurdity. I'm different than I was a few minutes ago. I'm different than I was before dinner. I'm certainly different than I was a few years ago. I always laugh and say, you know, when I buy a pair of shoes and I take them home and the next morning I go, who was that woman who bought those shoes? Right? And you want to call the shop and say, look, I know you won't understand this, but there was an insane person in your shop last night who bought the shoes. And yet the receipt has my name on it, but please take them back. Right? We don't know ourselves half the time. We're changing so rapidly. So Buddha said that because things are changing so rapidly, you could say that nothing has a fixed identity. Nothing is a bad person. Nothing is a condemned life. Nothing is someone who is unredeemable. Right? Buddha would say, he would agree with Shakespeare that nothing is good or bad, but thinking makes it so. And where does the thinking come from? We are born into a context in the world the way an actor is cast in a particular play. We can't help the prejudices, the ideas, the likes and dislikes of our family that are imposed upon us when we're young. No blame to the family. It's just we have traditions we grow up in. We have religions that we grow up with. We have a certain kind of education. We grew up on a certain block, maybe on this side of the tracks or that side of the tracks, and we have all kinds of feelings about that. So we are impinged upon from the moment we open our eyes. We don't experience the world in a kind of fresh way. We think we do. We think we're arriving constantly at any given party very neutral and open, and I'm just a sweetheart, and I just want to inhale the dear friends that are around me and the good experiences, etc. But in fact, we are coming with, you know, whips and chains of our own to any given event. So it isn't that there is an old event and we're arriving fresh. It's more like there's a fresh event and we're arriving old. We are the person we were yesterday, and we woke up in the morning, we began worrying about the same things, we began to rail about the same things we don't like. We are carrying with us all the time, in fact, an entire world on our backs, like a hermit crab or a snail. That world that we believe exists according to how we've been taught and grown up, and kind of worked our way through things. We are carrying those images, those ideas, those thoughts and prejudices and songs with us all the time. So it's like seeing things with a particular set of lenses. Can we agree on that? Yeah? Are you with me? Because I really want you to be with me as we go through this, or I won't be of much help to you. So I want to know where you want to say, wait a minute, hold on a sec. So you're perfectly free to do that tonight. I hope you will. So then when we run into problems, all right, we find that we have views that will change. So let's say something really sweet happens to us. Well, we feel that God's in his place and all right, is all right with the world, that, you know, things are just. We did things that created this situation and we were rewarded. On the other hand, if something really lousy happens to us, quite unexpected and very difficult, it's chaos. And we're in a world that's random, that's brutal, that's cold. Where is our God? Where is the goodness that accumulated in us at one time, but is not doing that now? Why me? I had a very dear friend who got breast cancer this last year. And the first phone call to me, she said, I wish I were anybody else. Why is this happening to me? So that's the biggest question. And that's the question that we really come into a room like this to find the answer to. Science can tell us how. They can tell us this molecule divided, or you know, that piece of radiation struck the body, or whatever, or this bit of asbestos got caught in the lungs. But when it happens to us, that's not the most important thing we want to know. We want to know, why me? All right? So the first thing we have to look at in that question is, who is me? Is there a me like we thought, right? Is there this person, this solid person, separated from other people, distinct from everything else, that stops at the skin? Who is me? So if you ask a mother or a father, they might have something to say with this thing about stopping at the skin, right? You know, mothers and fathers have been known to lift cars off their children. It's very interesting to me how that happens. How does that happen? Under other circumstances, that would be impossible. And we live with information like this, but we kind of just let it wash over us. Oh, well, that was an amazing event and blah, blah, blah. That stuff should be in the front and center of the paper every day, because we need to know how that happened, because maybe other things like that can happen. And my idea about that is, if everything is a field of potential, if everything is whirling, subatomic, quarks, bosons, everything is this kind of shimmering event, happening thing, like a river, right, or the wind, then what happened to that mother as she experienced the terror of her child? That mother became one with not just her child. That mother became one with everything in the universe. There was no separation. And the minute there was no separation with her child, there was no separation with the car. She could lift the car as easily as she could lift her child at that moment. And that was coming from the mother. Nowhere else. Nobody suddenly said, you know, the car no longer weighs such and such. The power was all in her. That's very, very interesting. And that's very interesting in terms of how we get rid of our afflictions. What we are convinced of, what our convictions are, what we have been taught to assume is true, can all be changed. Every single bit of it can be changed, because the nature of everything is change. We just need to understand it, and we'd be able to lift cars. We'd be able to walk on water. We'd be able to walk through walls. Many people have done it. We've read about them. We respect those people. And we'd like to know what's going on, right? Because, you know, you take an idea like the resurrection of Christ, and we can intellectually get behind it, we grow up on it, but if someone tells us that we can really change, that we could get rid of an addiction, for instance, or that we could go back into a marriage that we feel is just over, we lose our faith very quickly, very quickly. But we're talking about the same thing. We're talking about a kind of resurrection. Resurrection meaning another way of thinking who we are, another way of holding our definitions of ourselves. Our definitions of ourselves are extremely limited, and therefore we're living unhappy lives. Partly we're living unhappy lives because we don't believe that there's a way to live a happy life. We don't think it's possible. We keep looking for people who can show us the way. People can't show us the way, just like the mother. It's got to come from us. So this is another principle of Buddhism for those of you who just walked in the door. First one, everything's changing. Second one is, so why do we see what we see? It's a little bit like a moving picture, like a movie, that you've got a blank screen in front of you, and then you've got a light in a machine, and then you've got this tape running through, right, these frames running through, and when you look at the screen, you have one frame, which is a shot, what they call in film, a shot, let's say, of a woman crying. And then you have a cut, you have black. You don't experience the black because it's so fast, your visual perception can't hold on to it. But there's black. My husband, who's an editor, always says, you should get refunded half your money after any movie. So you're sitting in the dark for half of it. And then there's another frame, which let's say is a gravestone. And you say, ah, this woman lost someone she loves. That is not in the dialogue. Nobody has said a word. It's not in the script. It just says, close up, woman crying. Cut, close up, gravestone. That's all it says. And you are immediately writing the story. Buddha would say, that's how you're doing your life. There's this mind, there's this consciousness, which is like the light. And then there's all the education and the ancestry and the culture and the language and the belief systems and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. These thoughts all running through. And you are projecting it out in front of you. That your reality, your perceptions are coming from your own mind. And when you think about it for a minute, it would have to be true. Or why do some people like asparagus and some people, if they see it, they want to leave the room? There's no asparagus out there apart from your perceiving it. Or everybody would like asparagus or dislike asparagus because it would have the quality of being likable or dislikable. Are you with me now? Who've I lost? Who wants to go get a drink or something? Or suddenly needs to use the ladies' room? Okay. What I'm saying is, we've got this changing reality, this constantly flowing reality. How could there be asparagus in that reality that isn't constantly changing too, that isn't up for interpretation at any given moment? We might hate a damp climate. We fall in love. The night we fall in love, it's raining, and we take our lover's hand and we dash out and we just hold our face to the sky, and we're so thrilled to be wet. It's raining, right? All the movies always have it. Being wet is almost like the sign we've fallen in love. Partly because we hate being wet most of the time. So we all know somebody must be in love. Sophia Loren, she's wet in every bloody movie. This is part of the transformation that happens. There's nothing bad in the rain. without the rain, we'd be in a lot of trouble. Right? But most days, we're using an expletive as we lift the shade and realize that it's raining. Okay? There's nothing good or bad. And it's very, very difficult when we put some, we slot something into where I've just put the rain. The death of a child. A divorce. Right? The death of a loved one or a parent. Or some terrible, terrible setback. Now I say, there's nothing good or bad in that. I may lose more people in my audience. But you'd have to at least hold out the fact that with these lenses that each of us has on, we are each seeing something in our own particular way. So we might think that something is a terrible setback. If you think of children, this happens a lot throughout their lives, and their parents are saying, now hold on a sec, sweetie, hold on. I know that your best friend, you know, got elected to be the officer of the class. But you don't know. Maybe there's something coming right around the corner for you. Maybe this was not the place for you to be, even though you thought you wanted that more than anything. And the parents are constantly trying to, you know, roll things out forward, that perhaps there's something coming down the pipe for you that if you were over here, you wouldn't be available for. We have to at least hold out that it's 50% possible that with any given disaster, it might shift your life in a way that you're available for something extraordinarily wonderful to come your way. For me, the death of my father when I was 16 meant that I could become my father more quickly, or try to become him more quickly than I would ever have done had I been a rambunctious teenager through the rest of his being alive and perhaps rejected a lot of the wonderful stuff I was able to take on very young, and perhaps not even be sitting here teaching you now. Because it was a lot my father's views and his deeply personal sense of faith that I was able to take on young, simply because it was such a disaster in my life that I lost him. Mm-hmm. I was searching then for help in understanding how that could happen, how that could suddenly happen. And I was able to think like my father then. So, what is good or bad? What is good or bad? We all have illustrations of it in our lives. So, if you listen to this, you can start begin to feel the mind sort of having a bit of a struggle. What do I want to hold on to? What is this broad up here telling me? Do I want to let go? Do I want to let go of those things that I know to have been a disaster in my life, that I know caused me to feel like a victim, that I know I was a victim of? Very hard struggle. And I want to say to people in the room, if there are people in this room who were abused, I want to qualify my remark to say, in Buddhism, they say that we can bring in causes from other lives for things that happen to us even very young. That is a matter of your choosing to believe that or not. There are many elegant teachings that we even give in this room about that, to show why Buddha posited multiple lives rather than just a life. And that is a matter of your choosing to believe that or not. But a child that is in a situation of abuse needs love, and the adult that comes through that needs love and support, and really doesn't need to be spending a lot of time thinking through things like this. So I put a sort of time out, a parenthesis around those that suffered that way, because it's a much further distance for them to understand this kind of theory that's behind forgiveness. Because if you can take personal responsibility for your life, you've got a very short road to forgiveness. Because what you're able to say is, every single one of us comes in with a certain kind of propensity. I think mine was anger. I bit the doctor when he lifted me away from my mother, and he couldn't get me off his finger for quite a while. I didn't clearly realize he was trying to clear my lungs. I just didn't want to be interfered with at that moment. So I think mine was anger, which brought me a lot of strength in my life, but it also got me into a lot of hot water. Other people, it might be a propensity towards sadness, a propensity towards, let's say, judgment. I'm married to a man who is very even. I would describe him as even, whereas I'm dramatic. There's more weather on my side of it. And I think all of us, we could say, if, you know, parents that have children, you know, they just pick them up after being born and they go, oh my God, look, you know, this is the passionate one, or this is the quiet one, or this is the whatever. It just seems to be that way. We come in with a kind of propensity. So one place where we can take a kind of responsibility for our lives is we get to know that propensity, and we have to take heed of ourselves, you know? We need help, in a way, freeing ourselves from not overreacting in that particular kind of way to situations and to people. We can move out from there by thinking that if we see things in a particular way, if we are bringing into the world, let's say, our absolute hatred of our Aunt Sally, who was very tall and very thin and very judgmental, then people who tend to be a little taller, a little thinner, or sometimes judgmental, might be having a kind of sandpaper relationship with us. See, it's not just that there's a situation out there and we come to it so neutral, and look how we're victimized by that very tall, thin person that's judging me. Once we know that we don't like that kind of person, then we can begin to open our hearts and give the next tall, judgmental appearing person a bit more of a chance. So one of the things that Buddha was very clear about was that this is part of what he called the Four Noble Truths, which was the first thing he taught, where he said, life is suffering, meaning at any given moment in life, there's something wrong, whether, you know, you've got a toe that doesn't fit properly into your left shoe, or whether someone's dying, or whether it's just you've got to go upstairs for it again, right? I was thinking this morning, I love my garden. I have a beautiful garden. I work hard in my garden. This is the moment, it's always at the end of June, where the garden now starts taking over, and it's a long work day every single day between now and November, you know? Everything bloomed, and now it's got to be cut back, and the other thing has got to be cleared away, and we've got to carry it all into the woods, and we've got to fertilize, and we've got to make sure this is divided, and blah, 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 blah. Right? And I begin to have a little bit of a different relationship with my garden, whereas April, May, and the beginning of June, I just love my garden to pieces, right? Same thing in a relationship, right? The honeymoon period is April, May, and early June, and then suddenly July comes, and it's a bit overgrown. You know? There's a lot of deadheading to do, you know? Would you please just stay over there, you know? That's just a little too much, right? Whatever. Right? How does that happen? How does love go wrong? How do things go south? How do things become a pain in the neck that seemed like life itself a moment ago? Well, in terms of what I'm saying, in terms of our causing things, right, the second noble truth that Buddha said, he said, life is suffering, there's suffering. And he said, there is something that you can do about it. Something can be done about it. So, let's say you're in a new relationship and it's going beautifully. What caused the honeymoon period? What caused it Buddha said things are caused. We live in a causal universe. So that means that we have to get a hold of this worldview, this causal worldview. And it has to cover from one side to another. You know, when an actor performs a scene, an actor has to play one action from the beginning of the scene to the end of the scene. That means from the moment they open the door onto the stage to the moment that they exit, they're doing one thing in a scene. It's interesting, most people don't realize this. So it's a little bit like this with a worldview. If we don't have a worldview that covers from the beginning of the scene to the end of the scene, we're really going to suffer far worse than people who do have a worldview. Because we'll think it's everything's right with the world when good things happen to us, but when bad things happen to us, chaos. And so long as we're in chaos and we think that anything is random, we are going to suffer terribly. Because a worldview of randomness is the most brutal worldview that there is. It means that anything could happen to you at any time. You know, this is a little our experience, what it's like when we're reading the newspaper in the morning. It's like, you know, as soon as something happens in Connecticut, like what happened this spring, you just feel like you can't take your children to school, right? The world is random. Someone will walk into a school and kill my children. The world is random. Someone will, you know, somehow manage to break into the house tonight and, you know, I'll be raped or whatever. And you're just a little tighter, a little smaller, a little more fearful of just about everything. And then this is what makes Congress just shrink the way it does and harden. And we can't even move an inch on gun control, not even in the face of such a disaster. Because it's just, we think it's random. We don't think there's any remedy really for it. We think it's the nature of things. It's not the nature of things. Because you have to ask yourself, why do some people see a disaster like that? Why do some people not see it? Why do some people participate in a disaster like that? And why do some people not participate in it? Why are they thousands of miles away? Why? We have to keep asking these questions that a spiritual life demands. Why? Why are things so? Why are they the way they are? Because in a spiritual life, you've got to be a renegade. You've got to be a protester. You've got to be out on the front lines. And that's where we all want to be, or we wouldn't be in this room, right? We want to be the one that really discovers, that gets to the goods, that really is out there on the path, finding the answers. We don't want to just stay at home and pull the covers over our heads. Okay, so Buddha said things are caused. What is the cause of feeling I'm in love? The cause of feeling I'm in love is that you are thinking about that person 24/7. You are willing to do anything for them. It's a joy in your day just to be sitting back at work, like partly on your computer, but really thinking, oh my God, what can I get them for dinner? Mm. Oh, they love, oh my God, they love stuffed grape leaves. Where could I get that? Let's see, you know, and now in your mind's eye, you're going 50 miles out of your way before dinner between 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock. To get the stuffed grape leaves, and you're thinking, oh my God, no, what can I have with them? You know, you're already gotten the grape leaves now. You know, what's the setting going to be like? How am I going to set the table? Maybe we should eat outside. You know, this is your day. You're purely happy thinking about doing something good for another person. If you kept spending your day like that, the world would appear to you exactly the way it appeared when you fell in love, because you created the causes for it, because the world is coming this way. You see, if there was a wonderful world out there, why didn't it stay? If it was like a movie set out there, why weren't the actors continually playing their roles, the role of my beloved? Where'd he go? You know, what did he have, a costume change? You know, what happened in the script? Who wrote it? I was writing it. What went wrong? Okay? You are it. You're the me production company. You know, you do the lighting and the sets and the music and you do the casting. You do the whole thing. So if you continue to direct the play in a similar manner, if you continue to treat the person that you fell in love with the way you treated them when you fell in love, you will have the honeymoon period last. It will last because it has to be continually created. You can't sit back then on your laurels and then go, well, you haven't done much for me lately. That's the beginning of the relationship being over. The minute that that happens, the relationship is being recast. You're recasting. The person who didn't do anything for you lately is not the person you fell in love with. Right? They're another person. I remember I had a therapist once. We were talking about anger, and she was saying that she had gotten angry at her husband a few nights before. And she said in the middle of her anger, she had this moment where she broke down, and she turned to her husband and said, hold my hand, I just forgot who you are. That's transformative. That's what you gotta do. Just stop and turn it on its head. Take responsibility. That was like immediately turning it over, saying, I'm the one creating this problem. I just forgot that you're my beloved husband. What was I thinking? Let me just sort this through. I'm cranky tonight, right? And then you can have time in the evening to go back and say, what are the causes that I need to put into place? There's a wonderful improvisation that I learned years ago. It's absolutely miraculous to watch, where two actors are on stage, and there's a third actor that's out of the room. And so you say to the two actors on stage, you're going to create a scene. Let's say this is a man who owes you money, and you're going to get him to pay you the money tonight. You haven't seen him in 20 years. He's paying a visit, and that's all that they know, okay? So they cannot refer to the fact that this person owes them money. That's the rules. And they're going to have to get him to pay them the money tonight in the scene. What is so amazing is I have seen that improvisation done where within two lines, the person who came in from the outside said the thing that they were supposed to say. That's how fast they picked up the signal from the other actors. This is how we play out our lives. We actually are constantly making demands on each other and not cluing the other person in. But by our behavior, they're either getting it or they're not getting it. They're either thinking, what the hell went wrong with you tonight? What's up with you tonight? Where they're not getting it. Or they're getting it and going, oh my God, okay, sit down, we have to talk about this. No, I know what you're saying. I know what you're doing. Don't, like, soft soap this now. I know exactly what you're saying. Or we need a shrink to unwrap it for us. Right? We are doing this all the time. We are playing games with each other and not telling each other the rules. Right? And then we have these terrible, terrible afflictions. Right? Elizabeth, yes.
This has come up before in other teachings, and I think I understand what you're saying, and I agree so much with it. I think it's very powerful. I just think about families that I've worked with over the years where either one or both partners are engaged, for example, in domestic violence, or where there's some kind of dysfunction going on, and sometimes the most functional thing for a person to do is to end that relationship.
That's right.
You know, so that I always fear in a public talk, when people hear what you just said, a victim of domestic violence, you know, even just saying like, well, you know, why are you a victim? And the person could hear that and say, oh, gee, I must be creating those causes. And, you know, and I'm just thinking.
That's why I started with a caveat that I did.
Right, but that was about a child. That was about a person who's victimized as a child. There are adults who experience domestic violence, and the most constructive thing I think they could do is remove themselves from the situation for their own safety, and especially for the especially when children are involved, because we see, and again, this is outside of the teaching of Buddhism, and maybe this conventional reality analysis doesn't hold, but children who witness it in the mundane world often become victims or perpetrators themselves.
Right, exactly.
And so I'm not teaching Buddhism, you know, I'm just saying.
No, this is very good, Elizabeth. It's very good to bring this up. Because let me just put it this way. Let's say someone has gotten into a relationship and there's violence in it. And they stay for a long time. And they just keep trying and trying and trying. Right? The most loving thing to do might be to leave, so that you don't create a cause to be a target for another person's violence, which gives them the opportunity to be violent, okay? So you can at least say, I can remove a cause that way. And that can be the most loving thing that you can do. Part of the problem is that people describe that as abandoning a person that they know is in trouble because that person's violent, right? Okay? If the violence is not ending, you would have to say that you're a part of it, right? You know, you would have to say that. So, in order not to be part of it, that's removing at least one piece of temptation for that person to be violent, okay? So that could be a very loving act, right? But then what I'm saying, that the person who's been in that relationship, not the one perpetrating the violence, because people who are perpetrating the violence are at a level where they can't be thinking like this necessarily. They need treatment before they can get to the level where they could even think like this. But a person who got into that relationship can then work with what in their history, what historically has allowed them to think so little of themselves, right? To value themselves so little that they allow themselves to be in a situation like that. And that thinking can change. No one is stuck with that thinking, right? There is no such thing as a bad person, because there's no such thing as anything that's fixed. And it's really, really important, it's such a good thing that you're bringing up, Elizabeth, it's really important that we always, with anything that we're teaching in any kind of spirituality, understand that compassion is the highest thing that we can hold another human being with. There are causes for the person who is violent for them to be violent. There are reasons that they're violent. They're not violent randomly. They're not violent because they're evil. We all have violence in us. And very, you know, they say that thought is what they call karma concentrate. Our thoughts are very powerful. I think I taught one time here at a teaching that I sat down to hear a lecture of my lama, of my great teacher. And a very, very tall man came and sat right in front of me. And believe me, the thoughts that I had about him in the next 5 minutes were not nice thoughts at all. And a lot of it was this feeling of sadness and upset, of separation. Like, how could someone do that? How could someone who is that tall sit in the middle of any audience? You know, they just don't have the right. They should just know better. I mean, they'll see no matter what. They're just sitting over everybody. Right? That was my kind of thought. And the minute you find yourself thinking, how could someone, the recommendation is to just pull that thought back and think of all the times that you were thoughtless of other people. When we come into a theater, we often have a ticket, you know? And we're not thinking of how many people behind us can't see, unless usually it's a child, and then we're like going, oh, can you see? And I'll give you my coat. But we don't tell with anybody else, right? And we're always a little annoyed at the person who's taller than us, or lady, will you take off your hat, or whatever, you know? Take off your ponytail, whatever it is that's interfering with us. But we have these thoughts about each other all day. How could this person? How could they? How thoughtless? How stupid? How neglectful? Right? This is violence. And then there's also the violence. You know, we're going to, the next teaching that Rick and I do together is going to be on the art of appreciation. We do a hell of a lot of violence in this country towards ourselves. And it's the, I think, the biggest block to a spiritual path that there is. Because you see, if they say, if things are caused, if you have no harm in your heart, there can be no harm in your vicinity. This is how you get to heaven. I mean, there has to be a way. Great, great men and women have walked this earth and talked about it. We know from studying Tibetan Buddhism that there are high lamas that have achieved levels of happiness. They call it consciousness, really bliss, happiness. We can't even imagine. We're so busy working with external technology. They spent 2,500 years working with internal technology, with the mind, and what it can do. And it can do a lot. Yeah?
How would Jesus getting nailed to the cross fit in with that, though? Because
yeah, let me, I will, as a matter of fact, it's on my list to talk about. Resurrection. See, everything that is alive is represented by Christ, in that even winter into spring, you are born, you come into the world as a gift, you give it, you are crucified and resurrected. Nothing disappears. We don't need to fear death in a certain way. Nothing disappears. There is no physicist in the planet that would say that things disappear. Nothing arises from nothing. We stop believing in what they call spontaneous generation in the time of Aristotle. Nothing comes from nothing, and nothing goes to nothing. There are far more subtle levels of energy than we are used to hearing about. You know, we're all looking for who we really are, for our true selves, because we have this inkling that there is something pure inside. We know what our own greatness is. We have enough experience of it, we wouldn't be in this room. We have a sense that we can be something extraordinary. We have a sense that our lives can be extraordinary, that we can be happy. We have a sense of it, and we're like following it by the nose. We're just looking for someone to teach us how, which is what we try to do here. So when the three women arrived, the first thing they asked as they were coming, you know, to the sepulcher, who will roll the stone away? And that simply is a metaphor for how the hell are we going to get out of this? How are we going to get out of our own afflictions, our own doubt? How are we going to move into some other level of consciousness, of belief, of wonder, of living? And they say that after they encountered the angel, and the angel said, don't be afraid, they ran as fast as they could go, absolutely terrified, and didn't tell anybody. It took the next group. And, you know, imagine these disciples, imagine these extraordinary teachings that they'd gotten, the things that they had witnessed, And suddenly, they view their leader tortured, brutally tortured, and killed. And in spite of all he had taught, he looked quite dead. It was over. Suddenly, it was over. And several of them had run away, you know, at the moment that he needed them most. Imagine their shame, their confusion, their rage. And that's symbolic of the fact that we all want the final word. We want Dad to come and say, I'm now going to show you everything. I'm now going to teach you how the miracles happen. I'm now going to introduce you to God. Right? We want that to happen. I'm close to someone who lost their child last year at 6 months inside the uterus. And that mother said to me, I just want to know. I just want to know something for sure. She just had her baby, her second baby, alive and well, this week. And someone suggested to her that the first baby might have returned to her. And I talked with her about that. Because according to these principles, if we create the world that we see, I said, okay, you have an alternative here, a choice. And see, this is exactly what is at the crux of the matter. Well, I say it's in your hands. We have choices. So you could choose that you lost your first baby and that the universe is random. It happened randomly. You got pregnant again randomly. The first loss was so devastating, you'll never get over it. It will probably bleed into this baby's life. You will never feel certain of anything again. You will be a fearful person. You will leave the light on at night. You will have to sleep with the television on. Your husband won't be able to reassure you. Nobody will be able to reassure you. You'll be frightened that you won't be able to get pregnant again. You'll be frightened that you'll lose that baby. And it will go on. Or, it's not that it's true, it's as if it could be true, because everything is changing 3 trillion times a second. You could just hold out the possibility that the child came to teach you. We don't know who anybody is. The child could have come to teach you that you grew up in the year in between, and that you opened your heart to an extent that you never could have done otherwise. That you asked to be on a spiritual path, and someone that loved you just ripped the rug right out from under you so that you'd move along rather quickly and understand that most of the world is suffering just the way you are. Only you have a path, and you have teachings, and you have help, and most other people don't. And now you've got this huge heart, this bleeding, huge heart that understands. And now you have your baby back. And your life could be filled with joy, because Buddha would say, the one source of your happiness is helping another human being, or another sentient being, we've heard that. That's the source of happiness. Thinking of yourself, worrying about yourself, can't get you there, and we all know it. Because, I mean, we've been trying for years, you know, to look out for number one, and it certainly produces, at best, very mixed results. But in the moment that you're helping another person, you are not self-conscious, you are not worried, you are not depressed, you are not anxious, you are free, you are liberated. And when she had gone to seek help after the death of her first child, she went to a very spiritual man who said to her, in the time that you're trying to get pregnant again, help an organization that promotes the health of children, promotes the lives of children. Go to work there. You see, that's planting the cause. You be the cause for healthy children, for others. You make sure someone else has a healthy baby first. Then it will come to you. So that's a kind of law. You put the cause into play, and the result will come. That's what they call karma. It's not like a law of punishment and reward. So that's also for people who are involved in abusive relationships to know. It isn't because you were bad and you were punished. This is different from the theory of original sin. They say karma is more like what goes up must come down. It's more like natural law. If you lie, eventually people won't believe you. It just makes sense. A lot of people say this to me when they first come into Buddhism. They say, it makes so much sense. It does make sense. Because the Indians and the Tibetans and the Chinese and the Japanese, they were logical. They were thinking logically. So Buddha said, I don't want you around as a groupie. You just go along to the next guy. I want you to think. I want you to test this yourself. I want you to bite into it and put it in the fire and test it yourself. Because whose spiritual path is it? It's not Buddha's, it's yours. If it's not working for you, then what good is it? And you've got to make it work for you. You've got to test it out, try it out. So here's a principle, okay, for a happy life. For getting rid of afflictions. If you want something, you go after it by making sure that someone else gets it. It's always going to be paradoxical, and I just felt it right here. You've got to have that moment. It'll happen in your body, you'll feel it, where you just tighten. You'll tighten up and you'll go, that's not the way to get something. Mm-hmm. You know? That's not the way I get something. And you'll feel it somewhere in you. There'll be like a little claw. We'll go, I don't want to do that. I've been dreaming about the scone all day, and there's one person in front of me, you know? I just want to distract that person for a minute and say, oh, a scone and coffee, please, and say, I'm sorry, what did you want? But they say that the way to get scones is to make sure that that person gets a scone. I was just talking to a student of mine in Los Angeles. He said, I think I'm getting it. He said, I was going to the market today, and I was in the parking lot, and I got my cart, and a woman came up to me, and she said, where did you get that cart? And he said, you mean your cart? And he said, I had to walk quite a ways to go get, the reason she was asking, they were kind of hidden. I had to walk around the corner and go get another cart. And he said, I felt it in my body for a moment. What a pain in the ass it is to go get this car. And then he said, I just laughed at that, and I just tried to soften, and just said to myself, no, I overcame that. I overcame that for one moment. Hallelujah. Right? That's that rejoicing that's so important, that appreciation of yourself. You know, that if you make, you know, if you're chipping away at a mountain, just chip the heck away. Pretty soon, it'll come down. It'll just come down. You know? So rejoice at the, you know, no matter how small the gesture is, just be so happy with yourself. Please with yourself. So the resurrection, then the crucifixion, you know, the old self has to go. The old definitions of who we are, those lenses we came in with, we have to ask all new questions. We have to find all new definitions. And that's not easy. You know, Jesus said, you know, I don't have a father, I don't have a mother. When they said, you know, he was in the temple teaching, they said, you know, where's your mom and dad? You know, what are you doing here, smart aleck? He said, I don't have a father, I don't have a mother. That's what he meant. I'm new. Resurrection is terrifying because it's new. It's all new. To say to yourself, the way I'm going to get things is by giving them to other people, is completely, radically revolutionary and new and difficult. You'd be amazed. I mean, I tell stories in here all the time of the very tiny things that I was unable to do. You know, cutting the biggest piece of pizza. I'm telling you. Well, I'm hungry and my mother doesn't like pizza much, so she won't notice. Blah, blah, blah. I couldn't give her the biggest piece of pizza, my God. You know, it's not like there wasn't food in the refrigerator. And in those moments, just don't be upset with yourself, okay? Don't, please don't. Just acknowledge we are all victims of this. Just let it open your heart for a moment that we are all victims of this. We're all self-centered. We're all trying to get what we want in exactly the opposite way of the way we should. Because it just doesn't work if we're just thinking of ourselves. But we're all like this. So, you know, welcome to the human race. And then just say, this is so sad. I'm gonna get back on this horse and I'm gonna try. Because if any of us could be released from this particular prison, it would be worth it. And then just move on. Just move on. Okay? We can't wreck our lives by spending our time on this earth being upset with ourselves all the time, denigrating ourselves. We are magnificent creatures with this extraordinary consciousness, these hearts that are so capable of so much. You know, while on the one hand, you know, we see the horrors of the Boston Marathon, on the other hand, you saw the most incredible behavior. For me, you know, one outran the other. I thought that was an extraordinary thing to witness, to simply behold. It should have comforted us more than made us despair. We are extraordinary inside. We simply need to know a few things. You know, it's like getting coached. We just need to know how to do it. So, one of the problems around something like the resurrection is we don't want to go for it. We don't want to shoot the moon. We have these stories around us. We know even in our own experience how incredible we feel when we give of ourselves completely. But we just don't have the courage to go for it. And my teacher often says, you have to be smart to be a great bodhisattva, to be a Jesus, to be a Muhammad, to be a Moses. You have to be smart. You have to understand how reality is really working. Just like I'm saying, in order to get scones in your life, you have to give scones. So be careful what you give, you know. He also says, well, if you don't like, you know, baseball caps, be careful, because if you keep giving baseball caps, you'll get a lot of baseball caps, right? So the four principles again have to do with the fact that while life is suffering, there is a cause for it. We can identify and understand the cause of our suffering. There's things we can do about it. We can put a new cause in play for our happiness, right? Like produces like is the next law. Christ is all over this in Matthew. Like produces like. Good actions produce good results. Bad actions produce bad results. It's that simple. And that's true. Read Matthew 7. He's got the most beautiful teachings in there. And that's where he says, do unto others. See, that's like producing like. That's just smart. That's what they call enlightened self-interest. You want a sweater? That means it's perfectly fine to know when you do a gesture of good, that something good is going to come to you. You don't have to not know that to make it work. You know, like alchemy. I won't think of the word rhinoceros and then it will turn into gold. You can be aware. You can have it in your consciousness that you are doing a good action for the highest reason. Okay? Even so that something will be returned to you. But then that has to be for the highest reason. So that I can be happy and free. So that I can do more of this. So that I can help others do this. So they can be happy and free. So we'll all be happy and free. We'll be doing more and more and more of this. And then they say, it's not just a feedback loop, it's a spiral up. It's a spiral up. Karma grows. You know, just like telling a lie. You know, they say it's like something rolling downhill and gathering moss. Karma grows. If you don't do something about your actions, they are going to come back to you. Your actions have results. They have consequences. And the consequences will happen. So they say there are two ways to handle that. One is the karma flowers. Something happens. You find yourself rear-ending a car. You can't pull it back. You can't take the reality back. Okay? Or you find yourself yelling at someone you love. You can't take that back, sadly. But you can sit down afterwards and say, my God, why did that happen? I need to take responsibility for what I saw. If someone was being annoying, then it means that I've been annoying in my past. I had to have planted the seed of annoyance somewhere to see the tree of annoyance flowering in front of me. And it looks much bigger than the seed that I planted, so I want to disown it. Well, I'm hardly ever annoying. Well, too bad, you're annoying. You planted the seed and you didn't do anything about it, and there was a big fat annoying person in front of you, really annoying. Okay? They say the way to disappear an annoying person is not to be annoyed by them. Then I can hear everybody going like, oh, that's a good one, Lindsay. Yeah, that's a good one. Right? Because that's how I felt when I heard from my llama. It's like, oh, sharp. You know, clever. But it's true. What makes them annoying to you is those particular lenses you had on. They look like Aunt Sally, right? Something in your past has that kind of annoyance on it. You're wearing the tag, you know. You wouldn't be able to recognize it if you didn't know it. Let me put it that way. You know annoyance. You've been annoyance, so you're going to see annoyance in your world. If you are annoying, and the world is a reflection of you, right, then there's annoyance around. If you aren't annoying to other people, and you know when you are, if you interrupt them, right, if you override them, if you do that thing that they've asked you many times not to do or say, whatever, all right? You're asking for it. The tree will grow. Okay? So, this is an art. I encourage everyone to come in and learn more about it because you haven't been taught this. You've been taught to look out for number one. And no shame. That's what the people who loved us thought would make us happy. On a spiritual path, though, that is the opposite. It will bring you the opposite result. Thinking about yourself first will mean that you don't get scones, and then it will make you upset, and then you'll actually get to the point where you'll hurt somebody to get something you want, or you'll take it away from them, or you'll steal it, or whatever. Because it builds this kind of desperation, this kind of loneliness. I can't get what I need, this kind of poverty mentality, so I'm going to have to just grab it because the world is random and cruel. Just turn it upside down. I am surrounded, possibly, by beings who are trying to help me and teach me. I need to learn tolerance. I need to learn patience. I need to learn kindness. I need to learn how to go to the end of the line rather than try to get to the front of the line. I need to learn how to wait. I need to learn how to offer and give. These are muscles. These are feeling and thinking muscles that we have got to exercise. And they can be just as junior as anybody who goes flabby to the gym. We're flabby and we're rusty and we're stiff. In the heart. And in Tibet, they say the heart and the mind are in the same place. It's so beautiful. We're stiff in those places. So we have to practice. That's why they call it, in Buddhism, people say, I have a practice. I always thought it was so weird when I studied. What do you mean you have a practice? What's that? A practice? Well, that's what they meant. Is they're actually going out and practicing these things. And I'll tell you something from the point of view of being an actor. You practice a lot as an actor, right? You spend most of your time in rehearsal and usually less in performance. And what happens in performance is something will happen that you didn't practice. And you get caught. And you get caught. And that will happen in your life too. You'll be like really gung-ho. You'll say, I'm really going to do this now. I'm really going to plant these seeds of kindness. I'm really going to blah, 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 blah. One of the reasons you will get caught is because you are holding the world in the same way. You can't suddenly say, I'm going to be very generous now with that person I'm really annoyed with, who's really annoying, who's essentially annoying. I know they're annoying, because a lot of other people were annoyed with them too. But I'm going to be different. I'm going to practice now an act of kindness with them. And you practice an act of kindness, and they take advantage of you worse. And then you come back here and you go, Lindsay, this, you know, doesn't work, to say it nicely. Okay? All right, so I always teach this because when I learned this, this changed my life. Okay? This really changed my life. If the events that we're perceiving in our lives, one after the other, are happening because something we did in our past, something we're bringing to the party, is like a little missile flying in and exploding in front of us, okay? Then if I see something sweet to Bob, I come to the center and I go, Bob, you know, you look so serene today. And he goes, will you stop? You know, I just, for the worst day, I don't look serene. Like, please don't say that. You know, it just makes me crazy when you say that, you know? And I'm like, what? What? And I'm hurt, and it feels random, and then I'm in chaos. I'm in chaos with my friend. Where did my friend go? See, I forget who he is. Suddenly, that's the only reality, okay? Well, okay, so they say what a high yogi would do is, they say, you look down for a moment, and so you try to gather yourself so you don't react and yell back. Mm-hmm. And then you think, wow, it's really ugly when someone attacks like that, isn't it? It's really ugly. I must have attacked someone like that. Let me just think for a sec. What kind of attacking I might have done? You know, when did I lash out at someone? If I can't think of it right now, I'm going to think of it tonight, right? Before going to bed, I'm going to think of it tonight. And then I look back at Bob. Okay? Then another missile comes in. And Bob looks at me and he goes, oh, Lindsay, I'm so sorry. Why did I say that? I don't know. Thank you so much. Wow, I really do look serene. Thank you. Oh my God, I'm so happy. I love you. Whatever. Okay, the whole thing turns around. It's another missile coming in. The two things are not related. When you plant a seed, it takes time for the tree to grow, right? At first you see nothing happening. I know, I do it every spring, and I'm always like, please, you know? You don't see anything happening. This is so important to understand, because this can stop you from getting on a real path. The fact that you go, it's not working, okay? Cause and effect have to have a gap, otherwise they can't be cause and then effect. The thing has to flop over into the effect. It needs time. My saying something sweet to Bob was planting a certain kind of seed. The fact that he reacted not in kind didn't have anything to do with my planting the seed of kindness to him. I have to wait for that to flower. it may come up some other place, some totally unexpected place. Karma is a very complicated, complex thing. When you think of how complex your thoughts are, that's how complex the results of your thoughts are. They're all tangled with good and bad. And one minute you're thinking, oh, that person has lovely eyes, but God, why are they wearing that dress? Right? And then you get a karma and you go like, well, why wasn't it just simple? I did something good. Right? Because you aren't simple. But if then Bob says something unkind to me, this gave me more patience and tolerance and help than anything that I learned in the beginning of my spiritual journey. That one thing that I did was not having an immediate result in the world. I was experiencing something that I had created before. So it was like someone holding up to me, okay, this is what you need to do today at work. Okay. Be patient. Okay, you were pretty good at this at all. You were quite an angry person. You even bit the doctor when you were pregnant. Okay. So then when I see Bob lashing out at me, I go, oh, there it is. First thing I need to do today, be patient. Don't be like that. An angel just appeared to me and gave me my very first job for the day. See, you can really learn how to do this. So that it's happening all around you. You're going, thanks, got it. You know, here I go. Okay, in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. Oh, thanks. Okay.
Oh, really? That isn't me. No, I'm denying that one.
That's sort of how it goes. But you can get more adept at it, and it starts to be actually fun. It's fun because you see the results of it. It starts to create movement in your life and change. And 6 months, you look back and you go, my God, I'm so much happier than I was, and everybody else around me seems to be. This is amazing. I just want to take a bath in this. Janet, you know, took my arm before it came in, and it was like 15 minutes of, I can't believe what's happening around me. I can't believe how I'm feeling. Because she's working this system. And it takes a little bit of doing. It's, you know, it's like any art. You're going to be a little, you know, clunky at first with it, or you're not going to know what to do. You're going to need to call someone and say, I'm lost. Or, you know, you're just going to mess it up. That's fine. But remember that it's an art. Don't require of yourself to be a Carnegie Hall right away. Right? And get down on yourself or whatever. But it's a very, very important principle, this principle of, you will do something, someone else will do something back. Don't relate the two. Don't draw the dotted line. Or you'll be back in a random world. Why am I so nice and everybody else is so unkind? Like, what happened today? You know, I was all set to go. Just keep planting the seeds. It's just like Mary Poppins. She never sticks around, right? To see the results. She just plants seeds. Johnny Appleseed, just plant seeds, right? Pretty soon you'll be walking around in your own glorious fields. Because it works, and this has been time tested. I'm not up here saying, you know, this is my new self-help course, and this is wonderful. This works like crazy. Do you guys want to take a break? It's time, isn't it? And then we'll just do a little bit more. Do you want to get a drink or? Yeah. Thank you, anyway. We'll take a break. You know, we put a lot of work into a lot of things in our lives, our jobs and, you know, our things that we make, we're creative. And we want to become masters. We all would like to be seen as masters of something. And yet we do not put that kind of effort into love. Mm. We don't. Mm. We just expect our lives to work out. We expect our lives to just happen sweetly, and because we're good folks, whatever. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't do that. That's not how it works. As a matter of fact, I think the more that we kind of rest on our laurels, the less it happens. Mm. You know, I remember as a child, we all practiced piano with the books that Czerny wrote. I hated Czerny. I have to say, I'm sorry, Czerny. I really hated Czerny. There were four books, and then there were the Diller Quayle books. Oh my God, and they were such weird names. I didn't know who these people were. But these books we had to practice, and then you'd compare with your friends. Well, I'm on book three. I'm on book four, you know? And we had no idea what we were doing. We're all of us old enough at this point where we can consciously decide to be great masters of love. That's worth doing more than any of our jobs or any of the products that we create, the art that we make even, because without it, it can't sing. It has no depth. There's no sweetness. And if indeed the only happiness we ever experience is in helping someone else, doing something for someone else, then we would be abandoned in the wilderness if we don't become masters of love.
Say that again.
If,
please.
Yes. Even if you did say please, you would have an attitude. I used to say, yeah. What was that game?
May I? Mother May I?
Mother May I? Yeah. If you didn't say please and you had to go back. If you said please, you could take one banana turn. Yes, I will say that again. Okay. If our only source of happiness is helping other people, if the way we get what we want is by helping other people, and we don't decide to become masters of love, we're going to find ourselves alone on a desert island pretty quickly. We're going to find ourselves unhappy and kind of incomprehending as to why our lives aren't working out, because we're good people. Well, it's fine to define ourselves as good people, but we have to really look honestly at what we're doing, what we're thinking, saying, and doing. And we have this little book that we use at the center here. It was written by our teacher's teacher. It's called The Book. I mean, that sort of sounds, I don't know, like The Secret or something. It's just called The Book. I don't know why it's called The Book. It's just no big deal. But it has in it the top 10 misdeeds in Buddhism, just the way the top 10 in any religion has, you know, what to do and what not to do. And I thought I would just quickly go through them as how you would use them to practice with. Because you've got to do your charity. You got to do book 1 through 4 You got to do your de la quail. You got to do your exercises and your scales. And all of us have to do them, no matter how far we think we've gotten. You got to pay the piper. You've got to achieve real mastery. And I always say that mastery is not knowing what to do. It's having had all those disasters and having taken little post-it notes, put them up in the mental bulletin board. You know, when you're steering that boat again and you're headed for the rocks, you go, oh, I know exactly how to get out of here, right? You just get experience, and then you're able to steer. So the first one is to protect life, do not kill. It's often the first one in every major religion. And think about it this way, okay? If we create the world that we see, because there's no objective mind in our world that would establish an objective world. You're seeing it right, you're seeing it wrong, right? We just all see the world that we see. So we're all in our own world in a way, okay? Then to protect life is so logical, it's not even funny, because it's our life we're protecting. A good example of this would be if my way of having a bite of yogurt is to give someone a bite of yogurt, if I give Judith a bite of yogurt, in order for me to have a bite of yogurt later on, in order for me to have food later on, what is the difference between her mouth and my mouth? There is no difference. If by feeding her I am fed, this is the story of the loaves and the fishes. They didn't get lots of loaves and fishes all of a sudden. I'm certain that everybody sitting on that hillside took out whatever they had and gave it to everybody else and vice versa. And everyone was fed. There is no difference between his mouth and my mouth. And this is how you can understand compassion. It isn't that if you're stabbed in the side, I feel it. We're not trying, let's not be stupid about this. We're not trying to get there. You know, we're not going to get there, except perhaps with a child and maybe even not then. But that's about as close, I think, as you can get. Someone you love so much that you just practically feel it yourself. But we can decide, we can make an intelligent decision that someone else's pain is as important as ours. And that's a decision. That's all. That's just a mental act, a decision. And that's an act of faith. But then if you start acting out of that, that someone else's pain is as important as yours, you'll have an entirely different day. You will not be planning so much. You will not be so busy. You will leave time open. You will be available. Because you know that somebody's going to be in trouble. Somebody's going to be sad. Somebody's going to be angry. Somebody's going to be disturbed. Somebody's going to need you to go upstairs for it. And you're planning for that because you're going to become a master of love. So you go to bed the night before thinking, who needs me? Who might possibly need me to show up early, to help set up the chairs, to whatever? What could I do translucently that no one would ever know? I'll just go quietly in there and clean the room, or I'll just make the bed, or whatever. Right? That's becoming a master. Because believe me, those people at Juilliard, you know, they're trudging uptown with the cellos every day into these little box-like rooms, and they're going at it for hours at a time, and nobody's watching, nobody's patting them on the shoulder. They just made a decision that they're going to play Carnegie Hall. And what's so beautiful about it is there's no evidence anywhere that they're going to get there. But they say that the karma of devotion is what creates mastery. It's not necessarily just the physical dexterity from all the practice. It's the fact that you went back again, and you went back again, and you went back again, in spite of there being no evidence at all that someday you'll play like an angel. that's how you have to practice mastery and love, because people will come back and say, well, you know, like, nobody's been nice to me at work. Well, tougher than that. Are you going to be defeated by the world in the first round? It's going to take a little time. And then you will see it. And then you will experience it and feel it. And then don't stop. You keep going. And it's just as much a pain in the neck after 50 years as it is on the very first day. Mm-hmm. It doesn't get less a pain in the neck. It does get more joyful and more fun. Because you're very well aware of what it's going to bring. And you know the system works. And then it's like, oh, it's a pain in the neck to go upstairs, but
could you address the people who give so much that they drain themselves dry?
Yeah. Okay. Of course, anything good can be taken to a level where it's destructive. You can get neurotic levels of helping. Yes, you can. Yeah. You can get neurotic levels of anything, right? But let me just say this. Here are the four steps of a karmic path. One, you decide what your dream is. What is it that you want? Two, you find someone who needs that, and you're going to make sure they get it first. Three, you spend all your time, just like when you were falling in love, enjoying, thinking about how you're going to help them, how you're going to go about it. You know? If you're lonely and you're looking for a partner, let's say you go to a nursing home, there's a lot of lonely people there, and you pick one person, and you're going to be someone who goes once a week, once every 2 weeks, and you're going to read to them, you're going to bring them something little, a little flower, a little special tea, some hot chocolate, a little candy kiss. You're going to find just the kind of magazine that they like. You're going to massage their feet. You lie back all during the day thinking, what can I do, you know, right? And all the time you're dedicating the goodness of it to your being able to find the one that you love. You're going to help someone else. See, their mouth is your mouth. Their loneliness, right, is what you're going to work with to cure your loneliness. You cure one loneliness. This is what Christ said. You do it unto the least of these. You do it unto me. That's what he said. And it's true. Okay, so that's the third step. The fourth step is, of course, you carry it through. The fourth step is, at night, before going to sleep, you lie back on the pillow and you rejoice. You just go, 1, 2, 3, 4, you enumerate on your fingers all the beautiful things that you did that day. And you be happy about it. And then you think of good things that you saw other people do, and you'd be happy about that. You can't be a master of love if you're bummed out all the time and you're thinking of all the nasty things you did, how horrible you feel about it, and all the nasty things that everybody else did. Because then you're painting this lovely little hell realm for yourself as you go to sleep. And sleep is powerful. You can be affected in your deep unconscious by the thoughts you have before you go to sleep. So that's one of the steps they say you cannot leave out. They say if you put those steps into play in your life, you will not be like the person who's constantly giving and never receives anything. But I'll tell you something about that person. They're probably giving with a thought somewhere in the back of their heads, well, now they'll see me. Well, now they'll give to me. Well, now I'll get what's coming. It's probably a trade. You've got to give with the idea that you never expect anything back from it. Just with this knowledge, if I give, there will be giving everywhere. And interdependent with giving is the idea that you have abundance, the idea of having. They say giving is what produces wealth, giving. Not hoarding, not playing the market, giving. Because interdependent with giving is having. You can't give unless you have. right? You give, someone will give to you. And I'm telling you, when the karma ripens, it will fall out of the sky. It has happened to me. It will come to you by whatever delivery system. It will be so amazing, you won't believe it. You know, some kid in the street will pick up, you know, $500 bill. There is such a thing. You go, is this yours? And you go, yeah. Actually, no, you don't. You say, keep it, son. Okay, so protect life, the life that is around you that you're protecting, including your own, that includes your own, is the field of potential that you're working in to learn to love. So protect it. Do not kill. And that means down to the tiniest insect. No more like that, okay, in the summer. You take those animals out, you bless them, and you send them on their way. Do not, what have we got? Do not steal. Protect other people's property. This is a really sweet one. You can be doing it all day. Just straighten things up for other people. When you go in bathrooms and they're messy, just straighten them up. You know? Just do little things for other people. Don't walk away with their pencils. Don't take the magazine from the doctor's office. You know, how would you feel? They think it belongs to them. Nothing really belongs to us. You know, the Tibetans say, you know, you don't know. Tomorrow your shirt may be looking for another owner, you know. We don't really own things. But people think they own things, so they value them. Help care for them. Again, it's your world that you're creating. The things that other people think belong to them, you gave them. You painted the picture and put everything in it. You gave them those things. If you feel envious of them for having them, wrap them up again in your minds and give them to them all over again. Get rid of that thought. You know, it's just going to break down. It's going to fall apart. It's going to wear out. It's going to rip. It's going to tear. It's going to whatever. Rejoice that they're happy with this thing right now. It's not forever. Okay? You want someone to be happy when you get something. So be happy for them, okay? Do not lie. Do not commit adultery. Commit adultery. Okay? Do we need a lecture? Okay? Because this is this is betrayal of the deepest kind. It's a lie. It's a huge lie. And if you're living deceptively, you see, you're out of adjustment with yourself. You can only be lying to yourself. The world that you see is you. So you're denying this aspect of yourself. All right? If someone is taken, you know, their dance card is full. Move on. Lots of fish in the sea. And, you know, whenever you hold out against any of these, you get lots of points karmically. The universe sees. You get points. Because where the points add up is in here. You feel like someone who's got a lot of integrity, strength. You're clean. You're clean. And people see that and feel that. And they trust you and they love you for it. And you're an inspiration to them. You don't even have to talk about it. You're a stand-up person through and through. And that plays in the world. I can't see my glasses because I don't have my glasses on. So be sexually pure, okay? Help other people's relationships. If they're faltering, don't you be the guy that, you know, help people. You know, they're suffering. Do not lie, be truthful. This is a very hard one. For me, this is a very hard one. Not that, you know, like I go around telling everybody lies, but, you know, we have social lies, we have lies on all kinds of levels. And it's very hard to be truthful with ourselves. And that's part of this too, to be really truthful with ourselves. You know, if someone is on a case about something, it's really hard to say, yeah, you're right. You're like, well, let me do that. I'll get to that. You know? I'll get to that one. Just don't talk about that. You know, very hard. But this is so extraordinary because if you think about it, if the world, again, is a creation of yours, a reflection of yours, if you're truthful, everywhere is you. Because they say what happens if you're truthful, really truthful. What you say goes. They say you can reverse the direction of rivers. And again, this is what I began with, like a mother lifting the car off the child. If the world is you, if the mirror is clean, you know, what you're looking at is who you are. Everything is one. It's like happy land everywhere. Everyone trusts you. You trust everyone. People look to you. Right? You don't have to convince people to trust you. You don't have to work to be in a certain position. It's just easy. It's easy. So the river going one way is not struggling to go another way. It can go anyway, because you're like that. Okay? That's a big one.
It's what about being too blatantly honest?
Too blatantly honest? Well, again, you can have neurotic levels, right? The point is everything, wisdom needs to be informed by love. Right? It needs to be informed by love. If being blatantly honest, if you don't like somebody's shirt, you know, you really think this is a bad choice, right? You think it might even be good for them if they change the shirt before the party, okay? But they're really happy with it. What is the good of your wisdom then to them? Right? If it's not going to help. Yeah. I think people do get confused about that. Speak in ways to bring people together. This is a big one in our culture. We criticize constantly, and we are constantly, and not only with our speech, just with our eyes. Somebody comes in the room, you go, you know, that's divisive speech in my opinion. That speaks as loud as anything. Like, you know, bringing other people together. If you try this, you'll find out how rarely you do it. It's very interesting. It feels very new not to be critical and, you know, refrain from divisive speech, but actually speak, you know, to bring groups together. Speak gently. Don't speak harshly. And that includes sarcasm. You all know what harsh speech really is. I used to have a dog, Quincy, a little collie. And Quincy was a dog that if you said no, that was enough. If you said no, he would literally shrink. And it used to scare me when it happened, because sometimes a dog does something and you turn and you go no like that, and he would. Some people are like that. People are like that. They might not shrink, but you might be having that effect on them. You know, and it might affect your relationship with them forever. Speak gently. Let the world and you have an easy commerce. Once you understand these principles, you don't have to force anything anymore. You don't have to be so desperate. You don't have to impose yourself. You can sit back and let the fun happen, because these things that will flower in the future is constantly sliding into the present. Pretty soon you'll do enough of them that the present is just sweet. And that will inspire you to do more. And then you'll just relax. You see, you can't have a spiritual practice that isn't resting on the foundation of deep relaxation. So they say, actors, no pushing. You can allow things to flower and to happen. You can allow people to have their day. Because you're going to become the master of love. You're just inviting everybody into the living room. Whatever they need, stop it and take care of it. Just a couple more, and then I'm going to let you go. I know you've been here for a while. Okay. But they don't write the 10 in here? Oh, yes, they do. So, yes. Do you want to turn off the fan behind you? No.
I always sit here. All
right. Well, you created the cause for you not to hear me. Okay, useless talk. Gossip, okay? Meaningless talk. They say this is the direct cause of depression. Isn't that interesting? That what comes out of you as speech, which is so important, our speech, does so much in the world. If that's garbage, then you can't see yourself as being worth very much. And other people aren't going to respond to you as if you're worth very much. They're going to be like, oh my God, can I get out of here? Will she ever stop talking? Right? It just run on. It just doesn't mean anything. It's not significant. It's not careful. Right? And so you'll be shunned. And you'll get depressed. So, speak meaningfully. Listen more. Be quiet more. We all talk too much, including me. Craving, being unhappy that someone has some happiness. Being really suffering over it, that someone else has something that you want. Well, they're going to lose it. It's going to fall apart. It's going to wear out. It's changing 3 trillion times a second. Be happy. If you get something you want, you don't want people, you know, furious at you, upset at you. You want them to be to enjoy it with you. They say wherever you go, join in the fun. Whatever it is. You don't like reality TV, and Aunt So-and-so is watching reality TV, just sit down and enjoy the show. Okay? It's a little bit like you not resenting that someone else has something they like. Ill will. We do this all day long. Just slight underground rumble of wishing that someone was suffering who appears to be happy. We wish because we think that they're lousy people, they don't like us, whatever, that, you know, the pumpkin would fall on their heads, but something will happen. Okay, this is really destructive because you are only doing this to yourself. You're only tearing yourself down when you do this. Other people, they say, are more valuable than a wish-giving jewel because they say if you had a wish-giving jewel, you wouldn't know what to wish for. You'd wish for money, or you'd wish for something that would just cause you more problems. That the people in the world that you're having difficulty with are the angels that have appeared to you with the manual saying, well, I guess we've got to go over this one again. We're going back to book 3. Charity just aren't doing those scales very well. Right? So those people, you can say, okay, you and me, we're going to get to paradise. You just be as annoying as you like. I am going to muscle up with my patience. When I get there, I'll give you half the credit. I love that, the buddy system. Wrong views is the last one, meaning that you don't understand the way reality is working. You think, you know, that to get in front of the person in front of you in line is the only way to get the last scone. You think that looking out for number one is how you are getting the good things in your life. It's the opposite. It's always the opposite on a spiritual path. It's always paradoxical. And you will have that feeling as you practice it that I just felt in my tummy tonight, somewhere in you. Sometimes it's in my back when it has to do with money. I think, oh, what a great cause. I'd love to give them $10. I'd love to give them $1,000,000. I'd love to give them, I'll give them $1,000, $100, $10. You know, you're back. You just go from having a little aspiration because we're so limited, and then it opens up suddenly, your heart opens up, and you go, I'm really going to give them something that's going to make a difference, and then you go right back. Okay? Just observe that sort of bungee effect in yourself and say, okay, let me just settle down here. Let me choose a very small number of things to give to. What can I give them that will make a difference? And let me just push it even by a couple of dollars. Let me push my comfort zone. Because the spiritual path is not about being comfortable. It's about being happy and free. But as you're doing those opening forays, you know, you can't be an Olympian right away. It's stiff, right? It's uncomfortable to go to the gym. It's embarrassing. You embarrass yourself with your own thoughts, you know, as you write the $10 check. You just don't feel so good. Write the $12 check and just say, okay, that's as far as I can get today. And tonight I'm going to rejoice in those $2. It opened my heart. I worked this muscle. I've got a sore heart, but that's okay. If we'll have a recovery tonight. And I will see tomorrow that my breakfast is in front of me and that I'm okay. Okay? So these are the top 10. You can choose one a day. You can do three a day. You can do six a day. But choose one. Or one of your own choosing. Right? One of your own choosing. And just watch and pray, as Christ says. Watch and pray. See if you can accomplish things during the day. You know, action is where the practice will happen. You know, they say religion is what you do in solitude. Those moments to yourself where you make these decisions. And then you go out into the world, and where it plays out is when it's coming down and it's hard. That's where it lives. And that's what you want. You want a warm, living, breathing spiritual path. Right? You can meditate all you want and you can come to class all you want, but if it's not happening in that way, where you feel there's more warmth and affection in you and around you, and there's more truth telling, and there's more vulnerability, and there's more really leaving yourself in the room in that way, and the understanding that what you do for another person has to come back to you. Their mouth is your mouth. All right? And then just be patient. Just sit back and say, it will come. And don't you try to determine the time. Well, it's been 2 weeks. Lizzie said. Give yourself a year. Okay? Give yourself a good, nice amount of time to do a wholehearted, healthy experiment. I just wanted to read you. There was something that I saw. I don't know if any of you have heard of the writer E.B. White. He's a wonderful, wonderful writer. And he wrote something about his wife when she died. Let me just hunt for it. Very beautiful. Passing a quote from Ezekiel, who was an extraordinary prophet in the Old Testament. And he talks about doing a heart transplant on everyone. And he says, I will take the stony heart out of their flesh and give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep my ordinances and obey them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. I love the image of taking out the stony heart and giving you a heart of flesh. The bleeding heart, you know, the heart that hurts, you know, that we're all in this broken realm. That this is what we see. Yeah, here's what E.B. White said about his wife. And you know, I just pray that this is what would be said about all of us at the end. He said she was a member of the resurrection conspiracy, a company of those who plant seeds of hope under dark skies of grief or oppression, going about their living and dying until no one knows how, when, or where. The tender Easter shoots appear, and a piece of creation is here. That's an obit, you know? That's an amazing obituary. And that's the result of walking this way. And we can all do it. And, you know, we have a place like this to support each other and help each other, and there isn't one of us that finds it simple or easy. Do unto others, you know, is the most sophisticated phrase in the world, because nobody can do it. So simple. But you'd be amazed at how far you can go. So I really exhort you. I really ask you tonight. I charge you. Shakespeare always says, I charge you. To go for it. To really go for it. To go for this in a very big way. And do the experiment and see what your lives are like 6 months from now. 10 months from now. I think you will be very pleased. But you have to keep awake. And the way you keep awake is those people that come at you, that you would like to just step around the corner or say, I'm sorry, I have a phone call. Right? You move towards them. And you say, thank you for keeping me awake today. What do you have on the list for me? And anyone that you feel is a fixed way, they're a jerk, you know, they're an idiot, they're so angry, you know, they're a lost soul. Kierkegaard said, I don't care if the God that I believe in is even kind. I want to worship something of majesty. I think that's in all of us in a certain way. You approach the person that you're about to avoid as something of majesty, and you don't even care if that God is kind. And you think to yourself, if there were enlightened beings in the world and they really loved me, they would be in my face 24 hours a day to try and wake me up. If I'm not annoyed, how am I going to become patient? If I'm not dissed, how am I going to become tolerant? Right? The world is for me, and it's teaching me. Could be. And like my darling friend who had to make the choice about her baby, could be an angel, or could be just a really annoying person who's never going to change. It's in your hands. You know, this great book that we often read in here, Liberation, in the palm, thrust into the palm of your hands, each person that you encounter. Okay. Let's dedicate the good karma of being here. They say that when you do something good, if you dedicate it, you give away even the feeling of like, I'm so cool, I did something good. So that you can't get, you know, caught in the net of your own virtue. So you give that away. They say if you dedicate. So let's dedicate being here this evening to becoming masters of love and ultimately being a source of love for everyone that we encounter. So just close your eyes for a minute and get that dedication. Thank you for the great opportunity to teach you.